Good morning. You're watching All You Need to Know on Bloomberg Quint. I'm Darshan Mehta. Joining me on the show is Agam Vakil. Agam will speak about the FNOQs. And the general trade setup currently does not look good. Most of the Asian markets are down. Global Qs are down. And the S&P 50 is indicating a gap down of almost 50 points at this point of time. So closing in on the 10,500 mark in trade. So overall, at this point of time, does not look good. Now, if you're looking at what happened with the ADRs, ICICI, Tata Motors, Vedanta, and HDFC Bank, a drop of anywhere between 1.5% and 2.3%. That was the weakness that was seen. Only two counters managed to end with the green. That was Wipro and Dr. Reddy's. Now, crude is trading weak. It was down almost 1.5% overnight. The current status is indicating another half percent downtick on crude. So, Brent is now below the $66 barrel per mark. WTI is trading below the $63 barrel per mark. So there is clear weakness as far as crude is concerned. Now, how are the commodities panned out on the LME? Most of them ended with a negative bias. So copper and zinc were down almost 1.2%. Aluminium managed to hold on and tin managed to hold on. But apart from it, that there was a little bit of weakness that was seen. As far as China is concerned, copper and zinc have opened lower. You have steel, which is trading flat, and aluminium, which is also trading flat in trade currently. Most of the precious metals are trading with a slight negative bias, but yet flat in trade. FIIs remain heavy sellers in the market. They sold in almost 907 crores in the cash market. DI has bought in another 1,000 crores in the cash market. So close to $2.5 billion have been already bought by DIs in the cash market this month. FIIs have been continuous sellers in this market. Which are the important sectors? The mid-caps and small-caps were down in trade. There was enough selling that was going on in the mid-caps yesterday. Some of the sectors that managed to move up over counters in the FMCG and IT space. But you had the banks which saw a big sell-off. So you could see the Nifty PSU bank was down 3.5%. The Nifty Realty was down 1.6% in trade. So there was clear weakness that was seen. And if you see the 28-point drop on the Nifty, basically held by banks, ICICI, SBI, Axis Bank, HDFC also contributed negatively. While little bit of support was given to the Nifty by Reliance and Infosys. But Agam, what are you seeing in the markets?
Sure, Darshan, we did see some amount of weakness led by banks, as you can see here from the Nifty picture. But when it comes to the Nifty futures, we've seen an increase of open interest. So on the other hand, in the Nifty bank futures, we've seen a decline in open interest of as much as 5%. So unwinding coming along there. The India Volatility Index didn't move too much in comparison to the kind of moves that we've seen in the previous few days. Still now notch below the mark of 14. But and similarly, the PCR also remained largely unchanged at around 1.42. The big changes came in the options, and we've seen more writing coming along, 10,600 and 700 calls, which means that there is some resistance building on the upside. That said, there were no futures, stock futures, which moved in or out of the F&O band, but we did see longs in Ramco Cement, and among the other counters that we are tracking is Ambuja Cement, which saw a little bit of weakness. Those are some of those stocks that we are watching out for, and this is our own markets. But moving across to the U.S. markets, the new Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell spoke to the House Financial Services Committee for 3 hours on Tuesday. Here are the highlights of what was said.
The economic outlook remains strong. While many factors shape the economic outlook, some of the headwinds the U.S. economy faced in previous years have turned into tailwinds. In particular, fiscal policy has become more stimulative, and foreign demand for U.S. exports is on a firmer trajectory. What we've seen is incoming data that suggests a strengthening in the economy. We've seen continuing strength in the labor market. We've seen some data that will, in my case, add some confidence to my view that inflation is moving up to target. Gradually reducing monetary policy accommodation will sustain a strong labor market while fostering a return of inflation to 2%. Engaging the appropriate path for monetary policy over the next few years, the FOMC will continue to strike a balance between avoiding an overheated economy and bringing PCE price inflation to 2% on a sustained basis. My personal outlook for the economy has strengthened since December. And again, each member of the FOMC is going to be writing down a new set of projections and a new estimate of appropriate monetary policy as we go into the March meeting, which begins 3 weeks from today. And so I wouldn't want to prejudge that new set of projections, but we'll be taking into account everything that's happened since December. Flattening of yield curves in the past has been a sort of a precursor of recessions, but largely because in many prior recessions, The Fed had to raise rates quickly to, you know, to hold inflation down. That's not the situation we have now. It's very typical for the yield curve to flatten as short-term rates come up, as the economy strengthens, and I don't see a particularly large, there's always a risk of a recession at any given point in time. I don't see it as at all high at the moment. In the committee's view, further gradual increases in the federal funds rate will best promote attainment of both of our objectives.
Stock of the day is Crompton Greaves Consumer. There you have a JPMorgan report on the company, which was initiated a rating on the company, initiated coverage on this company with an overweight rating, indicating a target potential upside of a good 30% at a price of 300 per share. It says that it's a quality stock and has a solid earning growth, and it says that the company right now is in sweet spot given the favorable policy environment, and also seems to be benefiting out of the execution renewed, and growth strategy under the new management. It says that these two factors are expected to drive the better than peer earning growth, and it says that the risk reward earning ratio at this point of time seems to be favorable for the company given the recent dips that we have seen for this counter. It says that the stock is currently trading at a multiple of 34 times and 28 PE multiple of 34 times and 28 times, which is a discount to peers. Valuations are discounted despite the superior earnings that we are looking at the company, and it also says that they expect some kind of margin expansion, which has further room to the upside, given the kind of up move that we've seen in the last 2 years. It says the EBITDA margin is expected to be improving to 14.2% from the current levels of around 12%, and it also says that the company right now is well placed to deliver a mid-teens revenue growth CAGR over the span of next 3 to 4 years. If you look at the stock performance of the company in the last 1 year, the stock has rallied 22.5%. Year to date, it's a 14% decline that we've seen, and in the 1 week basis, it's been a flat performance. Also, if you look at the Bloomberg consensus rating, 25 out of 30 analysts that have been tracked by Bloomberg have a buy rating for this counter, while 3 of them suggest a hold, and nearly 2, as much as 2 analysts suggest a sell, with a return potential of nearly 23% for this counter. With that, let's toss it over to Saloni for rupee and bond market updates.
Thanks for that, Nikki. So talking about Indian rupee, it extended losses for the second day and depreciated by a marginal 8 paise to end at 64.87 levels against the dollar. Now remember, the home currency has depreciated by over 2% so far this month against the greenback. A modest sell-off in local equities along with rising crude oil prices largely weighed on rupee yesterday. All eyes will be on the GDP data for December quarter today, and it is expected to increase to 7% for December quarter versus 6.3% in the previous quarter, according to a Bloomberg survey. Well, moving on to bond markets, sovereign bonds gained yesterday as yields on the new 10-year benchmark security dropped 2 basis points to 7.67%. Now, remember, the 10-year bonds are poised for a 7-monthly decline on fears that the central bank will start raising rates sooner than expected. Well, on the global front, the dollar index ended near 3-week high yesterday after new Fed Chair Powell said his outlook for economy has strengthened since December, and the central bank could take more than three rate hikes this year to support the global growth. The dollar index jumped as much as 0.7% yesterday. However, it ended 0.6% higher at 90.40 levels. So elsewhere, euro slipped against the dollar after German inflation slowed down for the third straight month in February. And lastly, coming back home, dollar rupee is trading at 64.92 levels against the dollar in the non-deliverable forward market, which indicates a weaker opening for Indian rupee in today's trade. Having said that, let's shift focus to commodity space. Good morning, Jayesh. Oil prices have slipped over 1% overnight. What has been the reason for that?
Saloni, morning. Not only oil prices, in fact, the entire commodity space, that didn't do well, primarily on account of the dollar index that you have been talking about. That actually strengthened against the major currencies. So, you know, the entire commodity space has not been doing well. As far as oil prices are concerned, we are seeing some bit of softness come about for oil prices after a 1.5% slip overnight. Now, this is largely on account of the crude inventory data that we are expecting. So the inventory is likely to jump up as much as 9.3 lakh barrels for last week. And also gasoline inventory is likely to increase for a fourth consecutive week. As far as the base metals are concerned, the LME index itself closed about 0.7% in the red, with aluminium and tin being the only gainers. The other base metals actually slipped in trade. So aluminium actually snapped its three-day losing streak, and the aluminium cancelled warrants that rose as much as 5.8%. Copper and zinc declined more than 1% each, while nickel and lead closed marginally lower. Now, if you look at the Shanghai Futures Exchange, most of these base metals have started on a weak note, with copper slipping more than 1%. Moving on to the precious metal space, that was actually impacted by the strength in the dollar index. The gold slipped more than 1% and is now trading below the 1320 per ounce mark. Now, this is on account of the statement that we got overnight, which actually, you know, indicates that there could be more than three rate hikes this year. On account of that, the dollar index rose for the second straight day, and it actually reduced the appeal of commodities.
Well, amongst the stocks that we are tracking today is HDFC Limited, which has launched its QIP to raise about 1,896 crores. They have set the floor price for the QIP at 1,824.63, very close to the market price. Also remember that Bloomberg Quint was the first to report about HDFC's QIP opening. So that will be a stock that we will be watching for in trade. Cipla is another one where they have signed a distribution pack for two drugs in India with Roche Pharma. Don't expect too much positive reaction on that counter on the back of this news. We're also watching out for DLF, where they've said that their subsidiary has emerged as the highest bidder for about 11.6 acres of land in Gurugram for close to 1,500 crores. So do keep an eye out on that name. We're also keeping an eye out on L&T Infotech, which has said that their promoter Larsen & Toubro will sell up to 2% stake in the company, and that will be to meet the minimum shareholding public shareholding norms. In fact, they held about 83.7% stake as of 31st December, which they need to bring down. So L&T Infotech will remain in focus. That apart, we're also looking out for ICICI Bank. They've shared some updates where they've said that they have no exposure to the Nirav Modi group of companies, but they have said that they are a working capital lender to the Gitanjali group of companies along with other banks in a consortium, but they haven't shared the exact working capital loans that they have shelled out. So ICICI Bank is another one. Sadbhav Engineering has emerged as the lowest bidder for NHAI project in Gujarat. So that's another counter where we could see some positive reaction coming in. And we're also tracking Dalmia Bharat case, where according to a Bloomberg exclusive report, the Dalmia Bharat consortium is poised to win the race for Binani Cement. In fact, they've made an offer for 6350 crores for Binani Cement, and they have made this bid in consortium with Bain Capital backed Resurgence India Fund. So that's a joint venture between Bain and Piramal. So you need to keep an eye out for Binani Hold, which is the parent company, and Dalmia Cement on the back of this news.
MDs of public sector banks have been asked to detect bank frauds, consequential cases of willful defaults on time, and refer all these cases to investigating agency CBI. The Financial Services Secretary Mr. Rajiv Kumar tweeted, MDs have been asked to examine all NPA accounts exceeding rupees 50 crore for any possible fraud, and involve investigating agencies like DRI and ED in cases of FEMA or PMLA violations. Chief vigilance officers of public sector banks will vet complaints and coordinate with CBI for frauds that exceed rupees 50 crore rupees, the financial services secretary tweeted. Earlier in the day, the finance ministry had given state-owned banks a 15-day deadline to identify weaknesses and operational and technological risks in the banking system and take preemptive action. A group of executive directors and a chief technological officer will be constituted, which would make a comparative assessment of the operational risk management practices with the best in industry standards.
The
government releases economic growth data for the third quarter of the current fiscal, that's the December-ended quarter, and the general expectation is that you will get a number which suggests that the economic recovery is gaining pace compared to what we saw in the second quarter. Let's look at the estimates. Bloomberg poll suggests that you will see GVA growth come in at 6.7% in the third quarter compared to 6.1% in the quarter before that. GDP growth is expected at 7% compared to 6.3%. Important to compare it also to the year-ago quarter, because remember the year-ago quarter is when we had demonetization getting announced, although the big impact of demonetization came in Q4. But in terms of level of activity or level of growth, you are expecting both GVA and GDP growth to return to the same levels that we saw in the third quarter of FY17. Remember, over this 18-odd months, we've seen two shocks to the economy, first demonetization and then GST. And what all economists are watching to see is whether economic activity rebounds to levels that we had seen before these twin shocks. To gauge that, some of the sectors that are important to track are agriculture, manufacturing, and construction. These are also heavy employment sectors, so important to track even from the employment standpoint. On agriculture, not much of a change expected. In fact, there could be a slight decline in growth levels from about 1.7 to about 1.5%, say economists. On construction, though, you are expecting a significant pickup. Construction had remained modest in the second quarter at about 2.6% growth. You are expecting a substantially higher number on construction. Manufacturing was strong last quarter, and the expectation is that that will continue to be strong, and perhaps growth in that segment would move up beyond the 7% that you saw in the second quarter. Those are the three major sectors to track, and those are GVA growth numbers. Apart from that, always important to see the expenditure side trends to try and understand what is happening in the underlying economy. One thing which had raised a glimmer of hope of a pickup in investment activity was the gross fixed capital formation number. That segment had seen growth of 4.7% in the second quarter. In fact, that was a five-quarter high. People are now watching to see whether gross fixed capital formation continues to rise, and if so, is that a signal that there is at least a modest rebound in investment activity. Private consumption expenditure on the flip side was slightly weakish, not an outlier, but at 6.5% growth was slightly weaker than expected in the private consumption expenditure segment, but nobody really sees much or significant weakness in private consumption, at least not based on other high-frequency indicators, so perhaps that one will be steady as it goes. The final one to watch is government spending. Last quarter, you had seen government spending growth come down quite sharply, although there was base built into it as well. Remember, the second half of the year, the government's own finances have not been in the best condition, so some of the segments which get a boost from government spending may be weakish, and you may see government spending not accelerate as much as it has in some quarters in the past year to 18 months or so. The importance of the Q3 numbers is to the extent that it should fit into the full year growth estimates. The RBI now expects full year FY18 growth at about 6.6%. So you're basically going to retrofit that Q3 number to ensure that we are on track at least to meet that 6.6 number, or if we are on track to better that 6.6 number, because from here on, what everyone is watching to see is what growth recovers to in FY19. The RBI expects a pickup to about 7.2%, but any underlying trends in all of these data will help us solidify the forecast for the next fiscal year as well.
Let's now have a look at some of the stocks that could see some follow-up buying or selling depending on yesterday's delivery data that we got. The first stock that we have for you is Punjab National Bank, arguably the stock of the day yesterday. And it declined 12.2% to close in double digits for the first time in over 2 years now. The delivery selling came in at about 365 crores. However, the delivery volume that surged about 150% and was up at about 3.6 crore shares as compared to its 5-day average. The total volume also surged about 152% at nearly 22 crore shares as compared to its 5-day average. The second stock to watch out for would be Ambuja Cements. That declined about 4.5% in trade and saw delivery selling of more than 120 crores. The delivery volume was up 160% at about 49 lakh shares as compared to its 5-day average, and the total volume more than doubled at nearly 1 crore shares as compared to its 5-day average. Last and final stock to watch out for, Infibeam. Yesterday it dropped about 3.5% and saw delivery selling of more than 50 crores. The delivery volume actually more than doubled, and the total volume just saw a jump of about 38%.
And the big brokerage calls for the day first we have is ICICI Direct on Music Broadcast. Now, the brokerage has initiated coverage on the stock with the buy rating and a target price of 450. Now, according to the brokerage, the radio industry will thrive on expanding presence, and for Music Broadcast, it will be its wide reach and balanced approach which will aid growth for the company. Now, the company has maintained the healthy EBITDA margins in the past, and going forward, margins are expected to expand since the cost increase would only be inflationary. Now, the brokerage is expecting the company's revenue and EBITDA to grow at a compounded annual growth rate of 14% and 17% over FY17 to FY20. And as major capital expenditure for the company has been over in the past, the brokerage is expecting free cash flow generation going forward for the next 3 years. Now, the brokerage is also expecting the return ratios to improve, and the company is expected to start paying dividends. Lastly, it is saying that the company's return on capital employed and return on equity will expand to around 22% and 14% by FY20. Second, we have is Motilal Oswal on UPL. And the brokerage has initiated coverage on the stock with a buy rating and a target price of 945, which suggests a return potential of close to 30%. Now, according to the brokerage, UPL is in a sweet spot to grab the impending opportunity in the generics market. Now, products worth $3 billion are going off patent, which is a big opportunity for UPL. Generic pesticides and backward integration will drive the profitability for the company, while new launches and branded products would drive the growth for the company going forward. Now, the brokerage is expecting robust growth across all geographies, and in fact, UPL is expected to outperform the industry rate in major markets, according to the brokerage, and it expects the company's EBITDA margin to expand on better product mix and operating efficiencies. Now, the brokerage is expecting the company's revenue and net profit to grow at a CAGR of 12% and 14% over FY18 to FY20. It is also expecting strong free cash flow generation, which would improve the balance sheet of the company. Now, lastly, it says that it also has a bull case target price of close to 1,213 on the company, which suggests a return potential of close to 68%.
We are about to see the end of the cycle. And if you look at the bankruptcy code that this new government has brought in and has been able to operationalize, and the number of cases that are now going there, some of the largest cases are now on the verge of getting resolution. So I think, you know, the pace there is picking up, and that is something that's very welcome.
What about the tightening norms for the recognition of some of those loans? Is that making any difference at all?
I think, you know, the tightening norms have just come in. Of course, you know, the tightening norms will cause some amount of pain in the short term. In the longer term, it's something that we all aspired for, but it was difficult to achieve, given the fact, you know, the system itself isn't organized in that manner. But now that the norms have come in, I am sure that industry as well as the banks will all benefit from it ultimately.
The Modi government recently announced a major recapitalization. I'm looking at some of the details as we speak. For the banks there, and this is specifically for government-owned banks, isn't it?
Yes.
Is that going to be enough, though, or is there more needed from the government?
See, at this point of time, they have done a proper deep dive into the bad loan issues to determine how much capital is really going to be required. However, they have forecast a certain amount of growth rate. I don't think they have taken a growth rate that is beyond 12% for these banks. And therefore, you know, it all depends upon how the banks grow as to whether the capital will be sufficient for both regulatory as well as for growth. For regulatory requirements, it will be sufficient. We are 100% certain of that. How much it will also help growth is something that we have to see as we go along.
Well, here are a few stories that you'll find if you log on to the website bloombergquint.com. First up, more than 24 banks have decided to seek a forensic audit to establish if Mehul Choksi-led Gitanjali Gems indulged in fraud or not. That is, of course, in relation to the PNB fraud case. Nearly 165 public shareholders of Rico India, owning a combined stake of 2.3%, filed a petition at the Mumbai bench of the National Company Law Tribunal seeking relief. They've accused Rico of oppression and mismanagement. Well, that's all we have for you on this edition of All You Need to Know. Up next is Indian Open, and that'll take you through Market Open. Thanks so much for watching. This is Bloomberg Quint.